Thank you very much. Nice that so many people are interested. And first of all, I'm completely in favor of a third section in Milan. And I have convinced my prime minister that he should not ask for this. And he has promised his Italian colleague not to ask for the third section in Amsterdam. And I think it's now up to Italy to do its utmost to have this realized before the 1st of June, because we all know that if there are transitory measures after the 1st of June, that may end up in being the reality. So do your best, Italy, because I like to come to Milan. But okay, apart from that, the administrative committee meeting, my task is basically to put you a little bit up to date. You are all up to date, but tell you something. If you want to interrupt me, ask a question, please go ahead. I have 20 minutes, so I'm talking a little bit fast. First of all, the administrative meeting of February 8th. You know, the administrative meeting are the people, the politicians sitting together and making certain decisions. Well, first of all, they confirmed June 1 as indeed a starting date. So it's really going to happen. And there was some doubt about it because we have still some minor problems with the CMS system. There are always bugs. But there will be a new exercise in March, and I think everybody is confident that everything should be resolved by the 1st of June. Further, there was the outcome of the further judges selection. As you know, we had selected the judges during the first administrative meeting, but the Danish judge then decided that she didn't want to become a UPC judge, and we needed a further judge in France because the French president is very busy, so she was administrative tasks, and we needed a third judge in Munich because the judge who was nominated decided that you make more money on the Board of Appeal than as a judge, so he preferred to stay on the Board of Appeal. But okay, so we were confronted with that, and that has now been resolved in the sense that the advisory committee has had new interviews with candidates, and we have selected three judges, and we have given our selection to the administrative committee, and it's now a matter of the administrative committee to approve them. They cannot do that on the same meeting because there needs to be 3 weeks between the advice and the decision. And as we could only start interviewing after the 8th of January, you can imagine that you cannot do that in a week if you want to do a serious job. Then there was a decision about a further call for technical judges. And I will come to that somewhat later, which is not a pleasant news for the technical judges which already have been selected. But I will tell you something about that. Then there is another thing, a reserve list. Because I raised the problem that if you have, for instance, in the Netherlands, you have a local division with two national judges, but there is no further Dutch judge in first instance. So what happens if a judge wants to go on vacation? What happens if one of the judges get ill? Is then everything stopping? That is, of course, what we should not want, because one of the holy promises of the UPC is that we will have decisions within a year or at least 14 months. And if we start not to be able to keep our promise, then of course that is not good for the reputation of the UPC system. So I have installed about everybody, we should do each and everything to make sure that that is happening. Also to the judges, no demands, oh, it's France and August, I want to go on vacation. No, you don't get any extensions. Every time limit is a hard time limit. The only thing what can happen is that a judge can say, well, you have 3 months normally, but I give you only 2 months, because that's possible under the rules. So it's a hard and fast system, and it should be, because otherwise we are not going to manage the 12 to 14 months. So that's why I insisted to have a reserve list, and we get a reserve list, so that there is a Dutch judge, for instance, or Italy has already judges which are in the central division, so they can replace a local judge. There, the problem is not such a big problem. But what about Denmark? You have one Danish judge. If he goes ill, you can't. There's a case filed in Denmark. The case, what's happening to the case? So you need to have a Dane who is on the reserve list and who is called up then and who gets paid per case. That is my idea, and the administrative committee was in agreement with that, and we are going to do that. Then the complaints were handled against early selection. We had two judges who complained, why I'm not selected, I'm such an excellent judge, and how come? Now, these complaints were, of course, dismissed because we do a good job, and yeah, you know, they were not the best for the job. They were very good, but not the best for the job. Then something which is happening since the February 8 meeting. First of all, as you know, there is a big discussion about ethical rules for judges. And there was already some uproar in Budapest about, because the presidium had given their ideas about what these rules should contain. Now, it's not up to the presidium to make these rules, but it's up to the advisory committee in cooperation with the presidium to make these rules. But we agreed with the presidium on the rules, and now we have a complete agreement, and so now the ethical rules have to be rubber stamped by the administrative committee. In the meantime, there were about a letter of about 10 or 11 patent attorneys who wrote that they were very concerned about what happened in Budapest with respect to the possibility of being a technical judge and at the same time carrying out profession of patent attorney, and they thought that it should be possible to, on the one hand, argue cases as a representative in the court, in the UPC, and on the other hand, being a technical judge. But that letter was addressed to the advisory committee, to the administrative committee, and to the presidium. We have read this letter, but there is no good argument, basically, to allow that. So I think what has been said in Budapest will also be in the ethical rules. You cannot be a technical judge and at the same time represent clients in the UPC. You can imagine that is very problematic, and I think that is quite clear. By the way, it would also be very strange because a lawyer who would be a part-time judge cannot carry on his law practice, so why would a patent attorney be able to do that? Although a patent attorney can, of course, carry on his national practice and does his work as filing patents and doing oppositions and etc., but he cannot be a representative in the court and at the same time, on Tuesday he sits on the court as a technical judge and on Wednesday the same two judges see the technical judge now arguing a case in front of them for a client. And can you imagine, I mean, a law office which normally represents the pharmaceutical companies and then one of their partners is now should be dealing with a case about pharmaceutical patents, whether it's for a generic or for a pharmaceutical company. I'm not saying that the judge would be dishonest. No, the judge would be very honest, but this is not about what is really happening, but it's all about perception of the public. And we have seen that there has been a enormous uproar on social media also, people saying, how is this possible? That cannot be, it's not a good court, etc., etc. We want to avoid that. We want to have a good court, a court which is credible. And so this is one of the rules in these ethical rules, which will be in that rule. But there will be a further training session of the judges, certainly of the newly appointed judges. I think training is very important because what do we try to achieve is a training, of course, that they know the rules of proceedings. We will not do a multiple choice test. Do you know all the rules of proceedings? But at least you should have an ID, because one of the things what we want to know, what we want to make sure, is that a national judge who is also a UPC judge is thinking different when he has a UPC judge. It's very easy for a UPC judge to look at the rules of proceeding and say, oh, that looks a little bit like how we do it in Italy. I'm going to do it that way. That's not the idea. The idea is that we have a UPC court with its own rules and which has nothing to do with the Germans, how they do it, the Dutch, how they do it. They have to establish their own way of doing things. And I think that is very important. Of course, it's if you have been 20 years a national judge, it's understandable that you think in your national concept, but that is what we try to brainwash them to get out of the brains. They become now a UPC judge, which is something totally different. So training remains important. The Milan section, I have said, you have all my support, but I'm only a poor Dutch person, so I don't have the political influence. Maria, you should do the job. Okay, what was the outcome of the training in Budapest? Because I give you some examples. It was interesting, first of all these old people who drafted this rules of proceedings, give an introduction to the rules of proceedings. I don't think that was very interesting. I did it also myself. But afterwards, we had a discussion among the judges. Because the rules are nice, but what do the rules mean in practice? For instance, with PIs, what is a preliminary injunction? We have very different attitudes in different countries. In Scandinavia, they don't care about really. Oh, the patent has been granted, so it's valid. But that's not the way we do PIs in the Netherlands, for instance. So how do you do that? Well, we have some rules, but how do you interpret rules? What is urgent? Is urgent, it's always urgent because it's an exclusive right with a limited time period, or is there some rule? Well, the general feeling was 2 to 3 months after you found out about the infringement, that is still urgent. But if you wait a year, that's too long. Now, it can maybe be 4 months because you had to do some testing and you have a good excuse why you are somewhat later. But that was one of the outcomes. How valid does the patent have to be? How strong has to be the infringement case? Well, the idea was there that it's more likely than not that the patent is valid. It's more likely than not that the patent is infringed. So, in my view, a rather low test, in fact, to obtain a preliminary injunction. It was a discussion, is this done by one or by three judges? And you will, if you look at the rules, you will see that's not completely clear. Always. Normally it may be the full court, but sometimes it is not yet a full tribunal because there's only a PI. So then maybe the standing judge should be it. So that's, and then was the question, yeah, what's the EPO? How important is that EPO granted the patent, that it survived opposition proceedings? Of course, that will weigh a little bit, but that's of course not decisive because as we all know, very often, you know, a defendant comes with things which has not been seen by the European Patent Office. So you should judge for yourself. So it's not so that, okay, it has been upheld in opposition. Okay, so then we can grant a preliminary injunction. No, if the defendant comes with a new pertinent material and not a Me Too kind of publication, then you should still, as a judge, take care of that. Well, then a couple of other points, of course, preliminary objections. Because what you want to do as a defendant, and certainly in Italy and in France, you know, you are quite procedural, so you know how to put some sand in the wheels of justice. And to, if you are a defendant, you're not waiting for a quick decision sometimes. So you try to ruin the proceedings. And that is, of course, what should not happen. Now, there are preliminary objections, and we have discussed what you should do with preliminary objections. Should you suspend the case, which is not in the, it can be done, but it's not the normal rule. So the idea is basically preliminary objections, if they are not really serious, say, okay, we are going to deal with them during the hearing. Go away with your preliminary objection. Because it should not make that the case is going to last 2 years. Of course, if a preliminary objection is completely justified, that's a different kind of thing. I mean, if you start try to enforce an Italian national patent, well, then the preliminary objection shall probably will be a success, and we're not continuing with the case. Okay, what about court-appointed experts? Because I'm in Italy, so you are used to court-appointed experts. They're of no use, court-appointed experts in the UPC system. Basically. And so that's, I would say, the exception that you have a court-appointed expert. You know that the Netherlands, the UK, and Germany, we don't have court-appointed experts, very rarely. Because why? Because both parties have an expert. Not because you have a technical judge, because let's face it, the technical judge normally has not the level of, I mean, he can explain the basics, but he has normally not the level of a very specialist patent case. So you need real specialists. But both parties bring their experts. They have a written declaration. You go to the oral hearing, and during the oral hearing, you have these written declarations. They are there, and you can cross-examine them to the point, not what was the weather on Tuesday or something like that. Okay. So, I said already timing, but that's for me very important. So, again, timing, 12 months, make sure you are a judge rapporteur, hurry up, put them under pressure, the parties. Lawyers have to work hard, they are well paid, so let them work, you know, let them work from the first day, no problem about it. No lazy lawyers. So, but how do you conduct a hearing? There's nothing in the rules how you conduct a hearing. How do you do that? Do you start at 9 o'clock and you see how things go, or is there some organization? I think that there's nothing wrong telling the parties, hey, there are time limits. You get both 90 minutes or 60 minutes, and you know, and thereafter we are going to hear the experts. So the expert says, you declared this. Is this correct? Yeah, that's correct. Okay, I have some questions. The judge, I have some questions to you. Maybe they don't have questions. Then the parties can ask some questions. Thereafter, maybe you have lunch, or I don't know. And thereafter, you should have a reply and rebuttal, so you can react on the first round of oral argument. You have heard the cross-examination, and then you can reply and rebut these arguments. That, to me, is ideal, and you can do that if you are efficient in one day, because that's important also. We want it to be done in principle in one day. This exception was for the English, because they, of course, when we were with these experts together, there were two English, two Germans, and two French, and me then as the seventh dwarf, representing all of you, because the three big countries were represented. And the English, of course, oh, in one day you can't do that. You know, you need to be able to be 6 weeks in court sometimes. And we said, no, we want to have it in one day. So then, of course, political compromise. It can be take longer if it is really necessary. But the idea is really that you conclude in one day. Then the sunrise period is coming. Opting out, when? Well, if you want to opt out, you should not opt out. It's crazy to opt out. Why would you opt out? Give me a good reason to opt out. Because your patent can be invalidated because in one proceeding for all these countries. Are you really thinking that they are more strict than the European Patent Office? That they are more strict than the Dutch courts of the horrible Bundespatentgericht, who kicks out each and every patent? In the Netherlands, the last 3 years, one patent was upheld. You don't want to be in that national system, isn't it? So, of course, the UPC is not going to be so strict on invalidity. Of course, they need to find a European kind of standard. What is the European kind of standard? It will be the standard which you also find in the Boards of Appeal. So it's crazy to be afraid. Yeah, for me, if I see somebody opt out, he has a rotten patent. It's a good sign. It's a good sign. He doesn't believe in his patent. I tell my clients, if somebody opts out, oh, that's nice, because you know he doesn't believe in his patent. Opt out, why would you opt out? Don't opt out, I tell clients. You have a fantastic system where you can, in one proceedings, get a decision for 17 counties within a short time against a reasonable price. And don't forget that, of course, you can get your cost if you win, but you have also to pay cost if you lose, that's for sure. So, and then, I hear some clients, well, you know probably better, but I had a client who said, well, I opt out because I want to see how things go. And then if it goes very nicely, I may opt in. If I see that somebody is opting out and I'm the third party who is the alleged infringer, first thing I do, I go to Slovenia, I file an invalidity case, which I withdraw after 6 weeks, and he can't opt in anymore. So he is obliged then to file proceedings in all the countries. So that is not a good strategy, looking and then saying, okay, we can opt in, because that very much depends on what your competition is going to do. Something with respect to protective letters, because people ask me, can I file a protective letter during the sunrise period? Which makes sense, because otherwise on day one, you may be confronted with a PI and you don't have your protective letter. And the protective letter is something which is read by the PI judge. Is it protective letter? Certainly if you've asked for an ex parte, or if you ask for whatever measure against them. Don't worry, you cannot file protective letter. But don't worry, because the judges will wait 1 or 2 days before doing extreme things. So if you file the protective letter on the first day of the opening of the court, you should be all right. With respect to opting out, if you really want to do it, I would not wait until the last day. Because although I have some faith in the system, you never know. If you get 17,000 opt-outs on the last day, maybe something breaks down and you have a problem. So if you are really decided to opt out, do it in time after the sunrise starts. Last four remarks. The role of the reporting judge, very important, but be careful. It's still an adversarial system. So you have to bring the arguments as a defendant. You have to bring the arguments as a plaintiff. It's not the reporting judge who can help you with that. Hey, why do you not argue this? That's not possible. Saisie contrefaçon will not be in the French way, will be an exception. If you can't find the evidence, then you have a saisie contrefaçon, because it's intrusive. You will not get, I'm quite sure, immediately all the information. It first goes through the judge who decides which information you will get, yes or not. An appeal, be careful. It's not like in my country and also in your country. You do something in first instance, you lose, you say, oh yeah, you should do this, you do that, and you do it all over on appeal. No, it's not a de novo appeal, be careful. And you cannot add new facts, etc. So you should do a good job from the first day. And if you are the plaintiff, you better make sure that everything is in your first pleadings. Very important. Cross-border, yes, cross-borders are possible. I'm not going too into it because I don't have time. But yes, you can obtain decisions also for countries outside the UPC. Thank you very much.